Up next, we have Mark Jason Dominus, Systems Programming in Perl.
So the people who show up to Linux user group, I found out, don't actually actually know that much about Unix. And there's like a, you know, if there's a fundamental Unix model, like how stuff works in Unix, and if you understand how stuff works in Unix, a lot of otherwise strange behaviors become easier to understand. And so I kind of embarked on this project. I go every year in December and I give them a talk about how Unix works. And this turned out to be surprisingly popular. And so one year I gave a talk about an inode. What's an inode? An inode is the Unix system data structure that represents a file. Files are really important in Unix because everything is, well, every object that you can operate on is treated in one way or another as some kind of a file, and there's an inode for it. But this isn't the inode talk. I gave the inode talk one year, and then the following year I said, okay, well, what's the other thing that Unix has? It has inodes, which are like the nouns in the universe, and then it has processes, which are the verbs. The processes do stuff to inodes, and so I thought I'll talk about processes. Wow, boy, I wasted a lot of time so far. 5 minutes down, and I haven't even said anything. All right. This is way too small. Holy cow, what happened there? Oh, I know, there's a separate preference setting for fixed width fonts, because of course, why would you?
You can change your screen resolution.
Maybe.
Don't do it.
Up, wait, got it, mama space, size 12. All right, now we're cooking. Ooh. Yes. Okay, so you got a program, and then there's this file on the disk that has the program in it. And when Unix runs a program, it goes to that file on the disk, and it gets the program's actual machine instructions in some weird format, and it loads them into its memory, and attaches to that memory image of the program, it attaches a bunch of additional information, and that's what makes it into a process. And you've only got one cat program on your disk. It's in /bin/cat. There's only one of those. But there might be like a whole bunch of different cats processes all running in memory, all operating in slightly different contexts, doing different things, different arguments for different users. They all share that same program text that's on the disk because it's read-only, they may as well share it. But there's a separate process for each one. So process is like a running instantiation of this program that's on the disk. And so, you know, I can run cat minus n blah blah blah, pipe to cat something else. This is gonna run two processes, both running cat, but they're separate processes. They have separate identities. This shouldn't be too puzzling for anybody, right? You run ps, and you look for cat in the process table list, and you see, oh, well, these five users all happen to be running cat at once with different arguments, different contexts, doing different stuff, but it's all the same underlying cat program. Jeff, I couldn't remember your middle initial. What's your middle initial?
G.
G. Sorry. All right. So what else is in a process other than this program, other than the object code, which the jargon for the object code, the actual program that's being run, it's called the text, which is a little bit puzzling because if you look at it, it's like the opposite of text. It's a bunch of binary gibberish. As you know, if you've ever run cat on itself, right, and I suppose since you're programmers, you've all done this, right? Right, it looks like that, but that's the text. I don't know why they call it text, but that's what it's called. It's stored in a part of the file called the text segment, but that's the instructions. So what else is in there? Well, a process has a bunch of other attributes. It has an identifier number called a process ID or a PID. It has a notion of a current working directory. Every process has a current working directory. That's the idea of like, where in the file system am I now? If I operate on a file, where should I look for the file by default? And that's often abbreviated to CWD here. And it has a user ID. That's its owner, and who am I running on behalf of? That's called a UID. And then it also has a group ID, which is not used as often. In fact, actually, you might have at least a couple of these for various reasons that I don't plan to discuss. And it has a table of all the files it has open. So like cat, if it's catting out three files, or maybe it has one open, or maybe it has three of them open, it has this table that says, okay, here's all the files that I'm operating on now. And it has an environment. When you use environment variables in the shell, that's part of the shell's process. That's just a big piece of the program's memory that's set aside, and there's a special pointer pointing at it. It says, the environment's over here. Then when you like do like env, the env command to print out the environment, just goes and follows that pointer and then formats that big pile of data in some conventional way. There's a table of how to respond to signals. A signal is an exceptional event sent by the kernel, like if you control C it,
the kernel sends an interrupt signal to the process, and it consults its table to decide what to do. It has an alarm, I don't know, blah, blah, blah. We're going to talk about all of this. It has a whole lot of stuff in addition to the text. See, I should have said that. We would have saved 2 minutes. I'm sorry. Anybody have any questions? It's all good? Are you happy? All right, I'll see you next year. I tried that once. They got really mad at me. All right, let's see. So the Unix kernel has a few major duties. It has a zillion minor duties, but it has a couple of major duties. And one of the major duties is to manage processes. And managing processes is actually the interface is surprisingly simple. There's only a couple of things you can do. And the two main ones are called fork and exec. Okay, who of you knows about fork and exec? Who does not know about fork and exec? Who maintains a prudent silence? Even the guy in the back corner can't raise his arm. I'm so sorry. Right, so what does fork do? Well, fork is for making a new process. That's how you make new processes. Every process on the Unix system, except for the very first one that has to be booted separately, is created by a fork call. And then exec is how you run a program. It says, OK, I've got a process. I want to run a program in it. A fork takes a process and makes an exact clone of it, an identical clone. It's a new process, but it's got the same text, it's got the same environment, almost everything is exactly the same. Almost the only thing that's different is the process ID number. So it makes an exact clone of a process. And then what does exec do? Exec takes an existing process and says, no, I don't want to be running the program I'm running now. I want to run this other program, and the file is on the disk over there. Get the executable from there. So that, after you've made the clone opens up its head, scoops out its brain, and replaces it with some other brain. So now it's a different person. Oh, there we go. So that's how you make a new person in Unix. You don't like have kids. Instead, you clone yourself, and then the clone scoops out their brain and replaces them with the brain of Tom Christensen, and now you've got Tom Christensen. Okay? So that's how you do that. So it's kind of like a horror movie. Only if you put in Mr. Burns, it suddenly becomes funny, right? Sure. All right. This is a little too small. I'm sorry. So suppose you type ls at the shell prompt. You're typing along. You want to run the ls command. What's actually happening in there? There's already a process running your shell, which might be called sh, or might be called bash, or something like that. So you've got a process here running the shell. And the shell is reading from the terminal, and sees you want to run ls, what does it do to actually run ls? Well, the first thing it does is it forks, creates a clone of itself, and it's an identical clone. So here's the parent, that's the process that you typed ls at, the first one, and then when it forks, it creates what's called a child process. And then we got the parent clone and the child clone. And the child clone, since it's a clone, it's exactly like the parent in every respect, it's also running sh. Everybody cool on this so far?
Yeah.
And then the child process calls exec to run ls. It figures out which ls you meant by looking it up on your path. And oh, okay, it's bin ls. And then it execs bin ls and scoops out its brain, throws the brain that said, oh, I know how to behave like a shell, and throws it in the garbage. And it gets instead this brain that tells it how to behave like ls, and now it's ls. And then the parent, then ls goes and does its thing in the child. The parent is waiting around, and it waits for ls to finish. If it didn't do that, then if it went ahead right away, well, the next thing it's going to do is print a prompt. It would print the prompt at the same time ls was printing its file listing, right? And you get all the output mashed up together, and it would not look good. If you do ls with an ampersand on the end, that's exactly the same, except it tells the parent, don't wait, just go ahead. And so you get the prompt right away, and then ls prints all its output after the prompt. Anybody ever done that? Should we do it? Is it a waste of time? Let's do it. All right, here's ls. Oh, wait a minute, let's go somewhere better. See if I've done anything good under temp. Ls, there we go, that's ls. Now is it ls, ampersand. Well, it didn't come out as bad as I thought, actually. We got the prompt after the ls, it was sufficiently slow. What if I try this? Yeah, let's never see. Yeah, all right.
Fine.
Yeah, it came out. I can do find ampersand. Yeah, let's do that. Find slash ampersand. Yeah, there we go. And where's my prompt? Oh, it's in there somewhere. Oh, I don't know. Wait, this is a terrible idea.
I didn't say find slash ampersand.
All right, you can leave now. Fortunately, we're going to make another shell. All right, where are we? Uh-oh. Oh, that find is still running there, slowing down everything on my system. Whose stupid idea was this? And if you're the clone, you go work in the garbage dump, because, you know, that's why you're getting the clone made. So you gotta hope you wake up as the martini guy and not as the garbage dump guy. And then the other thing you have to do is you have to have a plan to figure out, when I wake up, how will I know if I'm the original or not?
There's no difference.
There's no difference, right? There has to be some difference, otherwise you're in trouble. Then, you know, you're gonna start fighting with this other guy about who gets to drink the martini. And that wouldn't do. So there's a couple of things you can do, and the easiest thing is, you can, when they do the cloning, they scan your whole body and they duplicate every cell, and they have a special magic marker in the clone shop that is invisible to the scanner, so the scanner doesn't notice it. So you can take that magic, they use this for like lining, like putting marks and stuff on you so they can align you in the machine, right? Everybody knows this, right? You've all done this, right? Okay. So you write on your arm, I am not the clone, and then you get yourself cloned, and it doesn't duplicate the marks because they're not part of your body, and the marker is invisible to the machine. And then when you wake up, the first thing you do is you look at your arm. And if it says, I am not the clone, you go drink your martini. And if not, then you trudge off to the garbage dump, because that was the deal. So Unix is very similar to this. Fork, you call fork once. Just like when you're in the clone shop, you go to sleep once, but you wake up twice. You call fork once, and fork returns twice. It returns in the parent process, and it returns in the child process. And the return value from fork tells the process whether it's the parent or the child. In the parent, it returns the process ID of the new child, in case the parent needs to know it. So say you have process 57, it forks, and that creates process 119. Back in 57, in the parent process, this returns 119, the new number. In the child, it always returns zero. So you look at the process ID you get back from fork, and if it says zero, that's like looking your arm and you see nothing. Oops, I'm the clone. So we get a process ID. The other thing that can happen is the whole cloning process can fail completely. And you wake up only once, so there's no clone at all. In that case, fork returns undef. So the first thing you do is you'll just say, okay, well, then I get undef, and if I got undef, something's catastrophically wrong, I couldn't fork at all. So we print out an error message. Most common cause of that is that the process cable got full, and and Unix can't create another process. But assuming everything goes correctly, you look at the process ID. If it's non-zero, that means you're the parent, so you're going to call wait, and that means just wait until my child exits. You call this, and it doesn't return until the child exits. But if it is zero, you're the child, you're the clone, and it's your job to go off to the garbage dump. So you go and you call exec, you scoop out your brains, and you replace them with the program, and you tell it, here's the arguments I want to run the program with, and that at that point, this program is done exiting. Exec, if it's successful, it never returns. Because you can't say, okay, what am I going to do after I finish scooping out my brains and replacing them with Tom Christensen's? Right? Because you don't get to decide. Tom Christensen gets to decide what happens next. And that's what's happening here. So a successful exec doesn't return. At that point, we run program, say ls, and it's going to do ls. If you end up here, it's because the exec failed, so you just call die. The clone has to say, oh, sorry, couldn't do it. And then order and harmony is restored, at least for the parent. All right, let's actually try this. It seems miraculous that this could really work, and yet, is this big enough? Who wants it bigger? The guy who decided to sit in the back row. All right, yes. Plenty of seats up front, folks. It was a lot bigger from up front. All right, let's see, what do we got? Ooh, no space left on device. What happened there? Come on. How'd that happen? Find is dead.
Log file.
Log file? No. Uh-oh, something's bad here. This is I could reboot, but we're not going to do that. We're going to struggle on. Let's see. All right, so there's our shell. And it prints the prompt. And now we're going to run a command. Let's say ls/temp. Oh, look at that. Flawless victory. Let's see, what else should we do? cat/temp. OK, well, cat says it can't do that. That's all right. What else should we run? What else is good?
Fine.
Yeah, that's not good. Right, and then let's see, we don't have exit, but that's okay because I said, it didn't work. We'll just use Control D. That shall terminate the diamond loop in Perl and then the program exits. Ooh, we didn't see a failed, we did see a failed exec. Let's see, what if I try a command that doesn't exist? Right? Then we got that couldn't exec, and the child process dies and says couldn't exec, and $! It paints no such file or directory. Couldn't find any program with that name. Okay, any questions about this? All right. Let's see what else we've got here. I would really like to know.
Did I chomp comparison before the chomp?
What? Did I do my test before the chomp? Let's see. Yeah, you're right. I did the test before the chomp. Oh well. Good enough for government work. All right, so we've got a shell, it runs a loop, it runs your commands, reports errors. What else could you possibly want? So why is there fork and exec? People from the Windows world often ask, well, why are these things separate, right? Because you always want to, you never fork except for exec, right? The whole point you wouldn't want to exec without a fork because that would destroy your program. You want to do the exec in the child process. And you only want to fork because you're trying to run a program, so duh, you should put them in the same thing. And that's what Windows does. There's some horrible Windows call, I don't know what it's called, but it's basically like, okay, create a new process, and that new process should run this. And the separation of this into two, into fork and then exec, is maybe, possibly, I don't know, I wrote this back in 2002, and I don't know if it's the most brilliant invention in Unix, but it's definitely in the top 10. This is a really good choice. And the reason is because it means that you can do stuff after the fork, but before the exec. And that means the child process doesn't have to have the same environment as the parent. So for example, if I run ls and I want its output to go somewhere else, that can be accomplished because after the shell forks, it can arrange this redirection. And then when it runs ls, ls doesn't have to know about the redirection. It just sends its output wherever and it ends up in the file because the shell did the trickery. And we're going to see the details of that in a moment. So each process has a table of open files indexed by numbers, 0, 1, 2, 3. And entry number 1, conventionally, is called the standard output. Typically, commands will write to file descriptor 1, open file number 1. And that's what ls does. It writes its output to whatever is attached, whatever is in that open file table in slot number 1. So here's a shell, and its standard output, its open file number 1, is pointing at some terminal device, dev pts3, for example. And then when the fork happens, the open file table gets copied. So now we've got two shells, and both of them have their standard out pointing to the same terminal, to dev pts3. And then when the shell does the exec, when it runs ls, the open file table doesn't change. LS just inherits that same open file table that the process already had. All it's changing is the text. It's not changing the open file table or anything else. So LS ends up with its standard out pointing at the terminal. So you just type LS as a shell prompt, you pound the enter key, and LS starts printing to open file number 1, which is the terminal, and you see the output on the terminal. So that's what happens when you run LS and it runs its data to the terminal. All right, but when you do a redirection, the shell does something cool. It does the fork. And then it says, oh, okay, but you wanted the output redirected to some place, some file. So then it closes file number 1, says, okay, I don't care about the terminal anymore. The child shell is doing this. And then it opens this file, temp files, and it attaches that to the open file table in slot number 1. And then the child execs ls, just like it normally would, and ls does exactly the same thing. So, okay, I'm going to write my stuff to the standard output. I'm going to write to open file table, open file number 1, only now, unbeknownst to ls, that's not going to the terminal, it's going to this file, and that's where the output goes. And so ls ends up writing into a file. It doesn't have to know, it doesn't have to care. You know, it's just, I write to open file number 1, whatever, man. You're setting that up as your problem. It's the shell's problem. So the shell does everything, and as a result, every program can have its standard output redirected in exactly the same way by the same shell. In Windows, redirecting output has to be part of that fork and exec call. It has to be an option in the fork and exec call. So the fork and exec call has to have an option in it for redirecting, has to have an option in it for setting an alarm clock, has to have an option in it for this. Every other thing that you can possibly do after the fork but before the exec has to be an option to that one function. And I gather that the manual page for it is like 187 pages long. All right. So, when you do a pipe, the shell does pretty much the same thing. It forks twice, once for a process that's going to run PS, and once for the process that's going to run grep. And the two children in between the forks there conspire with each other so that the first child process has its standard output pointing into this pipe structure. And the second child process has its standard input coming from the pipe structure. And then the first process execs PS, and the second one execs grep, and PS goes and writes, I don't care where I'm writing, man, it goes into file number 1, and that goes into the pipe. And grep goes and reads from file number 0, that's the standard input. I don't care what is attached to file number 0, but it ends up reading from the pipe, and so it gets the stuff that PS wrote into the pipe, and it greps the stuff that PS wrote into the pipe. PS and grep don't have to care about pipes, they just do exactly what they were going to do anyway. As far as they know, they're reading from the terminal, or writing to the terminal. Inetd does a similar kind of a thing. You tell inetd, okay, listen for network connections, and you get a network connection on this port, run this program, and arrange to have its standard input and standard output attached to the network socket. And then it goes and it does that. It runs the program, and the program ends up reading from a network socket and writing to a network socket, even though it doesn't have any networking code in it. How awesome is that? The alternative to this is every program has to understand the network, and when you upgrade your network stack, you have to recompile everything. That's impossible. All right, so here's a shell that actually does something useful. It's similar to before. It runs an infinite loop, it prints a prompt, it reads the command, it has the last and the chomp in the wrong order. At this point, this is supposed to support redirection, so less than and greater than. And the parser got a little complicated, so I separated that into a function. You take the user's input, you parse it, and that returns this command structure that has a program element for the name of the program we want to run, and arglist for the arguments. And then also, if there's a standard input redirection, it has the name of the file that standard input should come from. And if there's a standard output redirection, it has a name of the file that the standard output should go into. And it also has this append mode that says whether it should overwrite the standard output file or append to it. We can see that in a minute, but for now, basically, it just parses it, right? I don't know, it's a parser. I didn't want to give a talk about parsers, you know? What? No? Questions? Anybody? All right, well, anyway, the fork is exactly the same. We call fork, it returns twice. In the parent, it returns the child's process ID, so the parent goes to sleep until the child is done. And in the child, where the process ID is zero, the child is responsible for handling those redirections. So if the user said, we want to redirect the standard input, then we use this Perl function that redirects the standard input. This closes the standard in file handle and reopens it to come from this file. And if it can't open that file, then we drop dead. I don't know what you want me to do here. And then it does exactly the same thing for the standard out. The only difference is that instead of a less than, we use either a one or two greater than signs. And then having redirected standard in and standard out, we do exactly the same exec as before. We exec the command. And now the command is reading from its standard in, which might have been redirected to come from this file. And it writes the standard out, which might have been redirected to go to that file. And should we see the parser or should we have a demo first? Who votes for demo right now?
Demo.
Who votes for parser? Good, I didn't want to do the parser. All right, so this is working just like before. I run ls. If I say ls, ooh, I'm not going to be able to write any output because my disk is full. What are we going to do about this? Where did all that go? There must be some Perl swap file somewhere, but I don't know how to find it.
Pipe it to the cloud.
Pipe it to the cloud. Thanks, man. You know the game where you like take any statement that involves the cloud and you replace it with the butt?
Yeah.
Pipe it to the butt.
Is your dev null full already?
What? Is my dev null full? That's a great idea. Well, then I can't show that the output actually went there, though.
Is temp full as well?
Temp is on. Wait. Yeah, it's root that's full. How did I fill up both disks at once? This is so puzzling. Maybe it's time to ditch that 2 gig of goat porn. Did I say that out loud?
Only 2 gig?
It's not very high quality.
Oh, I know. It's not so much to do that. Did that work? Okay, that worked enough. Looks good? Right? And we could even, oops, no globs. I didn't implement star.
Yeah.
All right, so that's looking pretty good. All right, so it's a shell, now it's got redirection. It still doesn't have pipes. To be actually useful, you gotta add pipes and globbing. Globbing is totally trivial, because, at that point it's an exercise in parsing, right? You gotta figure out where the globs are. A Perl's got glob built in, and even if it didn't, you could like get a file listing Perl and run a regex on it, right? So you can handle the globbing with no trouble. No system programming involved in that. And pipes is slightly out of scope for a 70-minute talk, but if we had a 90-minute talk, I would show you the pipes. But, all right, sorry. All right, let's see. Just for completeness, there's the parser. It's not very big. We take the command, and we split it up on white space, and also we want to capture these less thans and greater thans. Those are interesting. And then we've got a list of words here. We threw away, this is, we even got the white space, right? And the grep here is to throw away the white space. We run through those words on the line one at a time, and if we find a less than sign, then the standard input redirection is the next word. When we see a greater than or a double greater than the standard output is the next word. And otherwise, we just push an argument. Yeah, question, please.
Have you thought about trying to combine this with like Perl brew or something and making a competitor to virtual M that Python has?
Have I tried to combine this with Perl brew and make it a competitor to virtual end that Python has? The short answer is no. I don't know what virtual end is.
Basically, like creates a self-contained Python environment that you spawn and you can do anything you want, has its own repository of modules. You can actually write stuff and then switch in and out of them and have different multiple ones running at the same time. It's really any feature because you can really prototype stuff quickly.
I'm not sure that would be useful, and here's why. This thing by itself is worthless, because if you want to run a shell command from Perl, you can call system on it, and that already supports pipes and redirections and glob and all that other stuff. So this is not getting you anything that Perl didn't already have in it. When you call Perl from system, actually, it invokes the shell to run the thing that you told it to. So this, like, two slides worth of code, I don't think has anything to contribute.
Maybe not this in particular, but just something similar, because it's something that's very attractive, makes Python very attractive for some people.
Okay. No, I guess I haven't. I had not heard of that before. Let's talk about it afterwards, though. Maybe there's something to it. Halfway, all right, 17 down. Gotta stop wasting time there. All right, well, so I said ls doesn't have to care where its output goes, but some commands do actually care. And so, for example, if I do, if I'm in temp here and I do ls at the terminal, it comes out in columns here. Let's do this. There we go. It comes out in nice columns, and the directories are in blue, and the archive files are in red. But if I send the output to a temp file, say, and then I look at what's in the temp file, it's different. Look, it came out as a single list, one file per line, and there's no colors, which is good, because colors are represented by horrible escape sequences that we don't want to see. And then, maybe more to the point, if you pipe ls pipe to grep minus I moon, right, it, grep gets one file per line. Instead of printing out every one of these three lines, because each line contains moonpig, it prints out only the names of the moonpig files. Right. So ls is actually doing something different if it's talking to a terminal than if it's talking to a file or a pipe. And so I said it doesn't have to know or care. Well, ls decided it does want to care. What does it do then? It's a little bit tricky. Ls, the first thing it does when it runs, not the first thing, one of the first things it does when it runs is it runs this call called fstat on its standard output to say, okay, what kind of device am I talking to? Is that a pipe or is it a file? Or is it a terminal? And then if it's a terminal, ls does its fancy colorized column formatting behavior. And if not, it just produces a list of files. And in Perl, the code, I offer three alternatives. If you love C, you can use stat, which gets information about a file. You say, okay, what kind of file is standard out? And you get back this array of all kinds of stuff. Element two is the mode. Usually you look at that because you're interested in the permissions, but it also contains the file type. And if you do this mumbo jumbo here and you get that, then it turns out it's a device file. And if it is a device file, you can find out what kind of device file by looking at the seldom used rdev value of stat, which has a pair of bytes that describe what kind of file. And the low bytes here, this 5 is a magic number I shouldn't hard code in my program because it's not portable. But it turns out that device type 5 is a terminal device. And I can say, oh, this is a terminal. Otherwise, it's not. So that's one thing you can do. If you're not crazy, then you can use the isetty function. TTY is short for teletypewriter, which is horrible Unix jargon for terminal. Anybody actually know what a teletypewriter is other than Tom? Oh my gosh, look at all these old people. A teletypewriter is used to. Is this big clunky machine that has a roll of yellow butcher paper coming out of it and a print head, and it can print 10 characters per second. And it goes, and when you type Control G on it, right, that's the bell. It, instead of going beep, because they hadn't invented that yet, there's actually a little metal bell in there with a little hammer, ding, right? Ding! And that's what we had back in the 1970s. And then like news organizations would like send information to the teletypewriter and the other news organization would print it out, and you've got an AP wire feed, and there's one of these chomp machines, and the AP would send you news dispatches. Did you already do that half over flag line for me? I don't know why I'm blathering about that. I'm sorry. Anyway, so that's what a TTY is. So this function is called isATTY. And you say if standard out is a TTY, it's a terminal, and otherwise it's not a terminal. Or you can use Perl's built-in minus T operator. You just say minus T, and that'll tell you if it's a terminal. Inside, Perl's minus T is just calling isATTY. isATTY itself could conceivably be doing this. I checked on my GNU Linux system here and found that it wasn't doing this. Instead, it's using this system called the IOPL. It tells the operating system to get the terminal attributes, and then if that fails with, hey, it's not a terminal, you dummy, it says, okay, I now know it's not a terminal. All right, that was relevant, good. Let's see. Oh, here's another example. This is not entirely accurate. I should, you know what, we're gonna take it out. Oh gosh, it just goes on and on. All right, good. Let's see. What else does the process have in it? It has this open file table, it has a process ID, it has a text area, and it has a current directory. Every process has its own idea of what the current directory is. And the result of that is that you can't write a Perl program that will change your current directory. Wait a minute, what did I call that?
PPW Unix command.
Ooh, do CD, that's what it's called. Right, so here's a Perl program. And it gets a command line argument, that's the name of directory, and then it tries to change the current directory to that directory. And then, having done that, it runs pwd, just to show you where it is. So let's say Perl do cd.pl slash temp. Okay, so it changed directory to temp, it ran pwd, pwd correctly reported temp, and when I do ls, it's not listing temp. Because what happened? We didn't go anywhere. Well, that didn't work. What if I do this? All right, I went up one. I went up from Unix commands, and when I ran pwd inside the command, there we are. But no, now we're back where we started. I'm harping on this because, man, I have this very, very clear memory of being like 18 years old and dealing with Unix for the first time, and I wanted to write a cd command which would change me somewhere and then like ls automatically. The ls worked, but then the change directory didn't work. I got so angry. I was so frustrated. And then somebody explained to me, no, this is never going to work. And I said, that is the stupidest damn thing I've ever heard. What is wrong with it? But, you know, I don't know. I still can't bring myself to believe it's the right thing, but it also, unfortunately, it's the only thing. And the reason it happened that way is, here's your original shell sh with this tiny little type here that says it's in home mjd. And when I run this do cd program, the shell forks, and the child process here is also in home mjd. And then the child process runs Perl, and then Perl does that chdir, which really does change, it really does change the current working directory. So now the original sh, though, is still in home mjd, and the Perl process has changed to temp. And then Perl runs a sub-process that runs pwd, and the sub-process inherits its current directory of temp, and pwd prints out temp. And then PWD exits, and then Perl exits, leaving the shell, and the shell, of course, never went anywhere because the chdir function was executed in a different process. And there is, in fact, no way for a process to change the current working directory of a different process. So you can't have a command that changes your current working directory. Bummer. And so I wish I could have told my 18-year-old self this, but he probably would have cursed at me just like he cursed at the guy who did tell him. So let's try shell2.pl. Let's see what happens if I do cd temp. Well, actually, it couldn't run a cd command because there is no cd command. Because you could write one, but it wouldn't work any better than the do cd I just demonstrated. It doesn't work. So cd has to be built into the shell. There's no bin cd. It's a shell built in. So we can add that to our shell here. We'll have a hash called built in. Names of built-in commands will be the keys, and the values will be code to run when somebody tries to run this command. When somebody says cd, well, you should internally, you should run shadir, which changes the current process's working directory, or issue a warning. And then after you parse the command, the first thing you do is if that command is in this built-in hash here, then don't do the fork and exec thing. Instead, just run the code that implements that built-in and skip to the next command. And then we can do, ooh, I'm still in Perl here, Perl shell 3.pl. All right, I can do ls, and I can do cd slash temp, and it runs that built-in, and now, ah, now it works. Look at that. So now we've got cd in there. Everybody happy? Or they still can't do this, right? Questions? It's good? Okay. It's supposed to stop at 12:30, right? What? Somebody said, and? Does that mean that it would be bad for me to stop at 12:30, or that I should stop sooner?
Just keep talking.
All right, so similarly, we'll just keep talking. Yeah, I can do that. At 2000 YAPSE, which was also in Pittsburgh, I had to speak the preceding day in San Diego. I told the guy organizing talks in San Diego, well, it's going to be tight, so I want you to schedule my talks for Monday, preferably Monday morning, because I got to speak in Pittsburgh on Wednesday. And the guy said, okay, and then he scheduled me for Tuesday afternoon. So I gave my 3-hour talk in San Diego on Tuesday afternoon. Then I took the red eye, landed in Pittsburgh like early in the morning, showed up in YAPSE just as it was opening, and Kevin Lenzo came to me and said, well, Joe Hall got snowed in Chicago and he can't talk today, so can you give some talks instead? And I'm like, man, I give 7 hours of talks that day. And so that's kind of my default, like it's switched on, I'll just start talking and I'm never gonna stop. Anyway, so exit has to be built in. An exit command would be useless, right? Because your shell would fork, the child process would run exit, which would kill the child process, leaving the parent process there not having exited. Totally worthless. So we can build we can insert this into our built-ins here. We'll have an exit command, which is called exit. There's very few commands that have to be built-ins. CD and exit are two of them. Umask is another one. You have to change the umask in the current process so that next time the shell forks, it will inherit the new umask. Changing the umask in a child process that's about to exit is useless. All right, let's see. Environment variables. You can't have a command that sets an environment variable in a different process because it's part of that process's memory, and memory is private. So there has to be a built-in command for setting environment variables in the shell, and then the new changed environment gets inherited by the children. This is true of almost everything in the process structure. Everything gets copied when the process forks, and the child process has its own copy, and it can change that copy, but it can't affect anything back in the parent. The program's memory is probably the most important example of this. When you fork, the memory gets copied, or the copy is simulated, but it's as if it was copied. So you've got some variable in the parent process, $x here, and it's set to parent, and then you do fork. Fork returns 0, then we're in the child. The child has x also. It has an exact copy of the parent's memory, including its x variable, and including the value parent in that x variable. We overwrite that with child, and then end up here, the child prints child, and the parent prints parent. So that works. The modifying the variable in the child doesn't affect the parent. Some stuff doesn't get copied. The process has an open file table. And so it looks kind of like this. I'm sorry, this is so small. I thought it was going to look better. And then, it's too late. No, we can't. Okay. Yes, it is too late to regenerate this. All right. It looks good when I looked at it last night. Anybody think that?
You can set view image as in the control plus view.
I can do what?
View image.
View image. Oh yeah, we can do this. That's a great idea. Hold on. That's much better than that find thing. All right, so here's the processes. This is actually, it's the open file table is called the file descriptor table. And in the original version of Unix, it had 20 slots. You could have 20 files open at once and no more. And that includes standard input, standard output, and standard error. So there's these 20 slots. These days, I think it defaults to like 256, and you can often resize it dynamically. So it has these pointers, but they don't point directly at the files. They point instead to entries in a system table that's shared by every process on the system called the system's open file table. And the open file table has a kind of a funny structure. Guys over there, I don't get to see what I'm pointing at. All right, so this is in the kernel, and this has a funny structure. It has pointers to the actual files, which are represented by those inode things, and then each entry also has a seek position. That's the position at which the next read or write will occur. So when you go and say, okay, I want to read from standard input, I want to read 50 bytes from standard input. The kernel says, oh, standard input, that's number 0. And let's see, oh, here, that means I need to go look in this file, and I need to get 20 bytes starting at position 29218. And it gives you exactly those 20 bytes, and it also updates this to be 20 bigger. So the next time you read 20 bytes, you get the next 20 bytes. And that's how the kernel keeps track of where you are reading along in the file. And then there's a whole bunch of really fascinating magic going on in the structure of the file system, so that when you say, oh, I need to read 20 bytes at this position, it can actually figure out what 20 bytes those are and where they are on the disk. This was really innovative in 1970. Now we take it for granted because Unix wins. Anyway, okay, so this thing is copied when the process forks, and the parent and child process each get their copy. Hold on a second, I have a nice, there we go. Right. But this thing, since it resides in the kernel, is not copied, it's shared. And that means that if the child goes and reads 20 bytes from standard input, and this number gets updated, next time the parent reads, it won't get those 20 bytes. It gets the next 20 bytes instead. Why is this important? Kind of a funny reason. Because here's a shell script. If it didn't work that way, this wouldn't work. This is the simplest possible shell script. It prints out, I like Pi. It prints out especially BlackBerry. Say you run this program, which is called Pi, and we want it to go into Pi file. Right? What's going to happen? The first thing is the shell sees this, it creates Pi file, and it attaches it to standard output, to descriptor 1. And it says, OK, I'm ready for writing. And the entry in the system file pointer table says, oh yeah, and the current position is position 0. That's what this guy means, is position 0. And then what? Then it runs the first echo. The shell forks, and the first echo here is pointing at the same output file, and it prints I like pi into this file, which now has its file pointer, its current position, updated to 12. Okay, next write in this file should occur at position 12. And then that first echo, it's done its work, so it exits. But the file pointer, which is in the kernel, is still at position 12. And then the second echo runs, and it says, okay, I need to write to standard output here, which is this, which is at position 12, and the second echo's write occurs at position 12 in the file. If that 12 didn't persist after the first echo exited, if it went back to 0, the second echo would do its write at position 0 also, and it would overwrite the data that was written by the first echo. So there's actually something kind of interesting going on here in order to make this work. All right, next topic. Any questions about that before we go on? No? Everybody's light at heart. Let's see. So you got a terminal window, like say this guy, and then you close the tab, what happens to the shell that is running inside that window? Well, it dies, but why? That's because when you close a tab, the terminal program, which may be Xterm or console or something like that, sends what's called a hup signal to the process that's running in the window, the shell. And then the default behavior when you receive a hup signal is to die. If you're a process, you get a hup signal. The kernel sees it sending you a hup signal, it just destroys the process. Hup is short for hang up. The original use case for this was you're dialed into the data center, because you don't own a computer, because only large organizations own computers, right? So you're dialed into the data center via a modem. Do we still have modems? I guess we kind of do, don't we? Yeah. And then sometimes, things being what they are, you lose the modem connection, and you don't want your shell to be sitting there taking up resources on the mainframe, even though your connection is lost, because you're just going to dial in again and get a new shell. So when the kernel detected that the line was hung up, it would send a hup signal to the process, and that would kill the process by default. So sometimes you like run some long-running process, and you want it to its output to go into a file somewhere, and you don't want the process to die just because your network connection got dropped. So you run the nohup command. You say nohup, and then the command and its arguments, you send the output to here, and nohup would arrange that if your connection gets dropped, this guy will survive the delivery of the hup signal. The kernel will still try to deliver a hup signal, but instead of dying instantly, it'll just keep going until it's finished. Shells have this built into the ampersand operator these days. It wasn't always so. Here's a. We're going to see the, how it works, and then we'll see Perl code for nohup. So every process has a table, a signal handler table, has a list of signals down the left side, and then what action to take on each signal on the right-hand side. The default is typically to die, but you could also tell the kernel you want to ignore a signal, or even that you want it to interrupt your program's execution and call some special function instead. And so some parts of this, so this tiny, tiny, tiny annotation here says, if you get a hup, then die. That's the shell. The shell forks, and the child process gets almost a complete copy of the signal handler table, including the instruction that if there's a hup signal, it should die. And then what does nohup do? Well, this guy execs nohup. And nohup goes and it changes that entry in the signal table to say, oh, if you get a hup signal, you should ignore it. Don't die, just ignore it. And then nohup goes and execs whatever command you're trying to run, which then has this ignore in place in the signal handler. So that's just yet another thing you can do in between the fork and the exec, is you can have nohup intervene and tamper with your signal handler table. Which in Windows would be yet another set of options to that fork and exec call. So here's Perl code. It's incredibly simple. There should be an argument list, which should be a command and a bunch of arguments. And if not, we'll issue a usage message. But if there is, we go into the signal handler table. This is Perl's interface to the signal handler table, and set the response for the hub signal to be ignore. And then we will exec the command and its arguments. And if that fails, then issue an error message. But if it doesn't fail, we don't have to do anything because now we're there. That's it. Questions? All right. Related to signal handling, there's a thing called an alarm clock. Every process has an alarm clock. You can normally it's off, but you can say, okay, alarm clock, I want you to go off in 37 seconds. And then 37 seconds later, at least 37 seconds later, the kernel notices the alarm clock's going off, and it sends your process an alarm signal. The alarm clock is not copied on fork. If you fork and you have an alarm clock set, the child process doesn't have an alarm clock. I don't know why that was chosen. But we can use this to make actually a fairly useful utility. Here it is, called stop after. It gets a number of seconds, a command, and a list of arguments. In case the alarm clock handler was set to ignore, we're going to set it back to the default, which is to die when the alarm goes off. Then we set the alarm, say, okay, go off, alarm clock, please go off in however many seconds, and then run the command. And now if you use this, you say, you have some command, and you want it to die after 30 seconds, you say stop after 30, command arg, 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 and it sets up an alarm clock to go off in 30 seconds, it runs your command, 30 seconds later, the kernel delivers the alarm signal to your command and kills it. And boy, I wish I had done that when I ran find, huh? Let's see, what can we do? Stop after 2 cat. So it's sitting there. Whoops, that was too fast. Stop after 5 cat. So I'm doing some cat. Ba 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 ba. Oh, after 5 seconds. So I actually use this command. Unlike all the other stuff I've showed you, I find this useful. As a four-liner, and who knows, you may find it useful also. All right, let's see. So, stop after 30, command arg, 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 forks, sets up the alarm clock, and then execs the command. Sudo, very similar. You say sudo, command arg, arg, arg. The first thing it does is it prompts you for the password, it checks the password. Sudo is a little funny because when the kernel runs it, it's already running as root. So it runs as root, it checks the password. If the password's no good, it dies. But if the password is good, then it runs your command as root. Nice, which lowers the priority of a process, it forks, and then nice runs, and nice changes its priority value, and then execs your command so that it runs a lower priority. Let's see, we got any more here? One more? Chroot. Anybody know what chroot does? Your program not only, your process not only has a current working directory, it also has a current root directory. Normally, the current root directory is the root of the file system. But some things, like system daemons, want to change it so the root of the file system is somewhere else, so they can't see any files above that directory. And you can say chroot some directory and then run this command, and that runs the command in a smaller environment. It's only allowed to see files under the new root. How much time have we got?
5 minutes.
5 minutes, that is exactly enough time. All right, here's a related useful thing. Suppose you've got some file, it might be modified at any moment by another program or by another user. And sometimes you want to edit it manually with like VI or Emacs or whatever your editor of choice is. You don't want to edit while this other program is modifying it. And if two people come to edit it at the same time, you don't want them both to be able to edit it at the same time. Well, Unix has a feature in it called file locking, where you can say, okay, this file is now locked, and that'll prevent anybody else from getting a lock on the same file. So in Perl, you import a bunch of F-control stuff having to do with locks. Here's the important file we're going to edit. Here's an auxiliary file that's not important that we're going to use to hold the lock. You can have a lock on the file itself. It turns out to be more complicated. This is much simpler. So here's the semaphore file. This is going to be like, semaphore is like a train signaling device. If the semaphore is down, that means that there's a train on the next piece of track, and you shouldn't move your train onto that piece of track, right? We open the semaphore file, and if we can't, then we drop dead. It's not safe to proceed. And then this flock call says, okay, I want to get a lock on the semaphore file. And it should be an exclusive lock, which means that if anybody else already has a lock, this call here should just wait and wait and wait, and it can only return once all the other locks have been released and we have the lock. It's also possible this could just fail completely. That's okay. So once this returns, if it returns successfully, we have the lock and nobody else has the lock. We are now allowed to be the only train on that piece of track. And then it's safe to open the file, modify it, close it. And then when we're done, we can close the semaphore, and that releases the lock, so somebody else can do it. So some program would be doing this. And then here's a little tiny wrapper program, kind of like the nice wrapper or the stop after wrapper, except instead of running a command with a nice value or running a command with an alarm clock set, it runs a command after obtaining a lock. So you call it with lock, you give it the name of the lock file, that's the semaphore file, and then the command and the arguments you want to run. And it gets the arguments. It tries to open the semaphore file here. And then if it can lock the semaphore file, it runs your command. So let's see how that looks here.
Enough room here for two windows?
With lock. Let's make the semaphore. Temp sem. With lock, there's the semaphore file. Emacs temp pi. Open. Oh, that was kind of weird. Oh, I did make here. That was kind of weird. Why did I do that? All right, let's try that again. Pi. All right, and there I am running Emacs. I like pi. And eventually, mask theory. Now, suppose someone, while I'm in the middle of editing this, somebody else comes along. Five? I thought we had less than five. That's good. I only need five anyway. In fact, I don't even need five. Here's somebody else comes over here and says, Perl with lock temp sem vi. What was this file called? Pi? Temp pi. Just hangs. Didn't run vi. Well, that's because it's waiting to get the lock. So I'm done with this. I'm doing my editing. When I'm done, I exit Emacs. Emacs, my first copy of with block releases the lock, and then the call exits in that other with block and runs VI with the lock.
And then if I'm over here and I decide, oh, I better go and I'm going to edit that again, well, actually, it just hangs until I'm done over here. So that works. Let's see. I think we may be done here. All right. So I learned all this stuff from this book called Advanced Unix Programming by a guy named Hotchkin, which was terrific. It's really thin. That's the first edition. Then there was a second edition. It was really fat. I didn't feel like the fatness added anything. So see if you can get a first edition of this. It's a great, great book. Also, if you like fat books, the Stevens book, of course, as everything Richard Stevens ever wrote, is totally brilliant and will teach you absolutely everything in every possible way. And everything it says is right. So, you know, Stevens. We all wish we could beat him. Any questions? Yes, Tom.
Two questions.
Two questions. No, you
one is easy because we just mentioned Richard Stevens, so you must have read it. You mentioned that fork is one of those, you know, we have a lot of functions that are too lazy to bother returning, you know, like exit or die or even exec, if you're unlucky. But we don't have very many that return more than once. Fork, the example you gave being the most popular. What's the second most common function?
Is there another function that returns twice?
Yes, it's in Stevens.
I don't know.
Setjump.
What? Oh, setjump, yes, of course it does.
All right. And setjump was a question.
He's
a
real one. We're going to never talk about setjump because nobody else knows what setjump is. Setjump
every
is
time you do any bad.
It's an abominable mechanism in C for doing a long go-to when an exceptional condition occurs. You can call setjump. And that records this structure that, like, supposedly records the system's, the program's current state. And then later on, you can take that package of state and pass it to a different function called long jump, which restores this program's state to what it was at the time you called set jump. So the first time you call set jump, it returns zero, and it gives you back a package of information that you can use later. When you call long jump, that set jump call returns again, because you recorded the state at the moment you called setjump, and then the long jump reinstates it. But it causes setjump to return a different value other than zero, so that you know that you're returning from it the second time and not the first time. And you can long jump to the same setjump multiple times, so it can actually return as many times as you want.
Yep.
Yes.
And Perl uses
And you should this. Never, never, never do this, because it's a horrible, horrible hack.
And that's why we use it to get out of to break out of the eval.
Right, the C being what it is, horrible hacks are a way of life. Yeah, that's where we are.
All right. Somebody else.
Anybody else have a question? Yes, sir.
So I just spent a long time last week with an example similar to your file locking, only to discover that it only works if it's another Perl program that uses the file locking system. If I, for instance, lock a file for 30 seconds, go to another shell and try to write to it using echo or something?
Okay. File locking does not prevent you from writing to a file. File locking is like a traffic light. Okay? You say, oh, I've got a green light. That means I can drive through the intersection. You drive through the intersection, another guy, right? Traffic light. He had a red light. Doesn't stop him from driving into the intersection. So file locking is like traffic lights. It only stops people who are using file locking. Traffic lights only stop people who pay attention to traffic lights. Doesn't guarantee there isn't going to be someone else in the intersection. It only guarantees that that everyone else has a red light.
Technically an hour time.
I'm really sorry. I have like a really short talk called File Locking Tricks and Traps that addresses that, maybe some other matters. I will point you to the URL, and it'll take you like 10 minutes to peruse it, and then you say, yeah, I wish I'd known that last week. All right, you, sir, and then we're done.
Just a fun thing about checking for a TCY back from earlier.
Checking for what?
Checking for a terminal.
Checking for terminal, yes.
A fairly commonly asked question is, I ran this system call or whatever, and then I checked $bag, and it said not a terminal.
Not a typewriter.
Not a typewriter.
Not a typewriter.
And I can't figure out why that happened. And the answer is, because your call didn't actually fail. And it didn't bother to check for that. And when Perl started up, it checked to see whether standard in was a terminal, and it wasn't.
All right. Well, Dan says we've got 1 minute, but yes. So one of the possible failures of a Unix system call is the wonderful not a typewriter message, which means you tried to do an operation on a terminal, but it wasn't a terminal device. And sometimes it happens that you check to see what's the last failure from a system call, and
since the last system call that was actually failed was something like miles ago that you didn't even know about that happened to fail with not a typewriter, you did like an open, it didn't fail, but you see not a typewriter in the dollar exclamation mark variable, and scratch your head, it's the weirdest message ever. Not a typewriter, what does that mean, right? And it means that you check dollar exclamation, it either means you check dollar exclamation mark when there wasn't actually a failure, or it means you actually tried to do like a terminal operation on a non-terminal device, much less likely. So, all right, we're done. Feel free to grab me. I will be here for the next 2 days, and I'll love to talk to you in the hallway. Thank you very much.
I figured.